Welcome to this video on hip x-ray interpretation, which is an essential skill to have as a medical student and doctor. If you find it useful, please consider a like and subscribe. Hip x-rays can seem daunting at first, especially when asked by a consultant to interpret one on the spot. I remember this happening to me as a student and panicking, having no clue where to start. By the end of this video, you will have learned a structured approach that will allow you to interpret any hip x-ray. The structure we use to interpret hip x-rays is ABCs. This stands for adequacy and alignment, bones, cartilage, and soft tissues and other. Before you start to interpret any medical image, it's essential to check the patient demographics, image time, and date to make sure that you have the right image for the right patient. Hip x-rays are usually taken in anterior-posterior projection, or AP, which means the patient is facing the x-ray source. However, to avoid missing fractures, it's also good practice to have a lateral hip x-ray to interpret alongside it. This video will focus on AP projected hip x-rays, as these are the ones you'll come across most commonly in medical school exams. Let's go through this structure one step at a time. First is adequacy and alignment, which is a quick assessment of the image quality. An adequate image means that we can see the entire pelvis from the top of the iliac crests down to the femoral shafts. An aligned image means that we have the coccyx and pubic symphysis in the midline. Next is bones. For this, we need to know the bony anatomy as highlighted here. We should be able to visualize the lower lumbar vertebrae, sacrum, and coccyx. The pelvis is also visible and is split into three anatomical parts, the ilium, ischium, and pubis. The two femurs communicate with the pelvis at the acetabulum, forming the acetabular joint. To assess bones, we need to systematically go through each bone, assessing the outer cortex and bony texture. When doing this, we should be comparing left and right for any asymmetry, which will help us pick up on abnormalities. There are three sets of lines that we should also assess here. The pelvic brim should be smooth and roughly circular. The two obturator foramina should also have a smooth outline and be roughly symmetrical. The final line to assess is Shenton's line, which can be found bilaterally following the medial edge of the femoral neck and inferior side of the superior pubic rami. Any asymmetry in the structure of these bones, discontinuations in their cortex, or disruption of these lines could be the result of a fracture. Whilst assessing the bony texture, we need to look for lytic lesions or sclerosis. These are both signs of malignancy, which could be from osteosarcoma or, more commonly, from cancer metastases. Fractures of the femur can be a common finding in hip x-rays. We classify these based on the location of the fracture. Broadly speaking, they can be either intracapsular or extracapsular. The hip joint capsule is a strong, dense collection of ligaments that surround the joint. The edge of the joint capsule runs along the intertrochanteric line, so fractures on this line or below are extracapsular fractures. Differentiating between intra and extracapsular fractures is important, as it changes the patient's prognosis and the required management. Intracapsular fractures will disrupt the blood supply from the lateral circumflex artery to the femoral head. As a result, these fractures often cause avascular necrosis. These patients therefore require a hip replacement, as the femoral head is unlikely to heal and reunite with the rest of the femur due to the poor blood supply. Extracapsular fractures don't usually cause avascular necrosis, so can be internally fixated with a dynamic hip screw. We can also classify hip fractures based on how severe the fracture is. This is called garden classification. Stage 1 is an incomplete fracture. Stage 2 is complete but not displaced. Stage 3 is partially displaced, while stage 4 is completely displaced. This patient has a left-sided subcapital fracture, which is a type of intracapsular fracture. It's garden type 4, so is completely displaced. Displaced neck of femur fractures, like this one, will usually cause the leg to appear shortened and externally rotated. This femoral head will need to be replaced. Notice the asymmetry between the femoral necks, and also the disruption to Shenton's line on the left. Neck of femur fractures are typically associated with elderly patients who have osteoporotic bones. They can be the result of a seemingly low impact fall. This x-ray shows an intertrochanteric fracture, which is extracapsular. This could be fixed with a dynamic hip screw. The lesser trochanter has also been completely displaced. Moving on to the pelvis, this x-ray shows a fracture in the superior and inferior pubic rami. These fractures occur together, as the pubis is a rigid structure, so one rami cannot break without the other. Notice here the asymmetry between the two obturator foramina. This patient also has diastasis of the left sacroiliac joint as a result of these pelvic fractures. Pubis fractures are also typically caused by falls in patients with osteoporosis. As part of our bones assessment, we also need to check the bony texture. We can see in this patient there's a lytic lesion in the right femoral head. This is metastases of a cancer into the bone. Common cancers that will metastasize to bone are prostate, kidney, lung, and breast. This patient has a pathological fracture on the right femoral shaft as a result of bone metastases. Look at the texture of bone throughout the pelvis and right femur. There are lytic lesions and sclerosis. The large circular opacity is an incidental finding, probably representing a large uterine fibroid. Next is cartilage. There are three cartilage-containing joints that we need to assess here: the acetabular joint, pubic symphysis, and sacroiliac joints. Whilst inspecting these, we are looking for any signs of arthritis or dislocation. This patient has severe osteoarthritis in their left acetabular joint. There are four osteoarthritis signs that can be remembered using the mnemonic CONS. Cysts, which are fluid-filled sacs, sometimes found in the femoral head. Osteophytes, which are small bony growths. Narrowing of the joint space, which should be 3 to 5 millimeters in a healthy adult hip joint. And subchondral sclerosis, which is where the bone underneath the cartilage increases in density. All four of these signs can be seen in this x-ray. This gentleman has a posteriorly dislocated right acetabular joint. This is the most common direction for the hip to dislocate, but occasionally it can dislocate anteriorly. This patient would likely have a shortened and internally rotated right leg when you examine him. There's also a displaced fracture of the posterior rim of the acetabulum, which is commonly associated with posterior dislocations. Hip dislocations are most commonly associated with total hip replacements, and it's a common complication after the operation. This is due to stretching and damage to the ligaments surrounding the hip joint during the operation. This patient has widening of their pubic symphysis, known as pubic symphysis diastasis. In adults, this space should be less than 10 millimeters. This female patient presented with hip pain immediately after delivering a baby. It's normal physiology for the pubic symphysis to widen during pregnancy and childbirth. However, in rare cases, there can be complete separation of the joint. This can be difficult to manage, as women postpartum are high-risk surgical candidates. This x-ray shows subchondral sclerosis around the sacroiliac joints bilaterally. This is sacroiliitis, which means inflammation of the sacroiliac joints. It's a common cause of lower back pain. It can be caused by arthritis, a traumatic injury, and sometimes infection. To finish off our assessments, we assess soft tissue and other. Here, we're looking for any effusions, for example in inflammatory joint diseases like rheumatoid arthritis. We might also see signs of periosteal reactions, which could be a result of healing fractures or cancer. Calcifications, for example, phleboliths or arterial calcifications. And foreign bodies, like you can see here in the form of bilateral total hip replacements. A total hip replacement means both the femoral head and the acetabulum have been replaced. A partial hip replacement, or hemiarthroplasty, involves just replacing the femoral head. Thanks for watching this video on hip x-rays. If you have any suggestions for future videos, please comment them below and I'll get back to you. Please also consider subscribing and liking the video. It helps the channel more than you might realise. Thanks, and see you next time.